Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Online Marketing Show. My name is Chris Johnson, and I work for A4U, who are knowledge partners, helping out the marketing show with some affiliate and performance marketing based sessions over today and tomorrow. This session is about launching a client in performance marketing. We've enlisted the help of David and Florian. David's from 17's Media, a digital agency, and Florian from Commission Junction. Chris was supposed to be, Chris Bishop was supposed to be presenting on this, unfortunately he's unwell. He's up to do the food poisoning, he's got the kitchen meal last night, but we'll go into that. I'll leave you in the capable hands of David and Florian.
Thanks, Chris.
So as Chris says, apologies that Chris Bishop couldn't be here. Contrary to reports, he's not at Wimbledon. What I'm going to do is I'm going to run through kind of basic steps in terms of affiliate marketing and how we looked at a program, namely USC, and working in conjunction with the network with Florian at Commission Junction. The main kind of steps that we put in place to give you guys some takeaways on it. Just before I kind of start, just a hands up of advertisers in the room. Okay, good. And agencies and affiliates? Okay, perfect.
Good networks.
Any networks, yeah, I missed that. Okay. So, to kick off, the contents are up there, but I guess the main thing is to take a look at the affiliate marketing industry, a few facts and figures around that, but then to look into the case study of USC specifically, what were the underpinning kind of values and strategy that we put in place, and then how we kind of implemented that with the network help. And then looking at the, you know, some kind of key or core takeaways can be applied at whatever stage of the affiliate programs that you have. And then if we've kind of got time to look at some of the wider opportunities within affiliate marketing, so they're not just affiliates, but online in itself, which are probably sessions within itself, and one of them, you can see the one in third analyst was up here earlier, but we can sort of talk around them. So a little bit about 17's Media, for those who don't know. We are quite a young agency, we're only 2 years old. We specialise in affiliate marketing, but also other performance channels, and we the clients that we work with are into retail, fashion, and confectionery. And recently, did quite well in terms of being awarded best agency and shortlisted for the awards last week for early May for our work with Asian Provocateur. So, if we look at marketing overview, click here. It doesn't work. Perfect. I guess affiliate marketing can be quite a difficult channel to truly understand the value because there's so many external stakeholders. The data that we look at and kind of use most regularly is from e-consultancy, who work with the networks to understand what clients are kind of paying out in particular areas. So if we take a look at the snapshot, this kind of differs a little in terms of whether it's either online or offline media that might start to plateau. So affiliate marketing is still showing some robust growth. And it's in no doubt, just to take this on further, if we look at the channel for this year, it's predicted to reach over £5 billion, which again is a kind of very strong growth area. Affiliates predicted or approximately taking home around about 280 million. So it's a very strong kind of core channel. Looking at the IMRG top 100, I think there's around about three brands out there that are not undertaking in affiliate marketing. But I guess, Florian, just on that point, whether it's a top tier brand, mid tier brands, the programs are in different stages. Are you finding that from their website?
I mean,
mean, I guess what one of the points here is, and for anyone who's not familiar with affiliate marketing, is, as David said, most big brands will have some form of a presence in that channel. And it brings the channel itself to quite an interesting point, because over the last 2 or 3 years, we've seen some consolidation on the network side, and we've seen a lot of new players enter the arena as well, particularly on the agency side. Small agencies like Seven Things Media coming into the space and making a name for themselves, as well as big agencies, kind of the traditional media agencies, building out a specialism in it. And it brings the whole channel itself to a stage of where you could call it grown up in most ways, and if there's any such thing in online marketing. But at the same time, well, every player within the channel is at very different stages. Some of them have exited only a few years ago and are still exploring it, whilst others are at a point where they've probably reached much of its potential and they're looking to get more out of it. And if you look at the brands that are up here on the screen behind me, and I can't actually read any of them out to you, but most of them will have been in the space for quite a long time and will be quite experienced at it. So the way they go about extracting more value from the channel matters, and it's probably where most of the growth areas are. And I think the case study will lead you quite nicely into how that works for some of the brands and gives you some insight into that.
For some of the more mature programs, are you seeing that the affiliate marketing budget or the affiliate discussions are actually in conjunction with all of the online, you still seeing that as a kind of separate channel?
And it's quite interesting. Again, you see very different approaches to that. Some companies will take a very integrated approach to that and make it work for them that way. And they'll still look at it in isolation and look at each channel in isolation. Both kind of models have some merit. I was at a talk a few weeks ago where somebody said, the earliest place where you start integrating things with each other is if all of them are mature, because if you do it too early and some of them aren't quite there, what you're likely to do is you're disintegrating the ones that aren't mature. So if, you know, some people, as I said before, some people haven't got their affiliate marketing programs in a mature state yet, so for them it's probably too early and it's wise for them to look at them in isolation, whereas others are much further down the line and they're looking at it really from a holistic point of view.
Okay. And to, you know, a key component of growth, and you know, I'm not going to, again, this is probably a session in itself. We all know in terms of vouchers or voucher codes in terms of model, it's a kind of core part of affiliate marketing at the moment. As you can see here, you know, taken from one network, the kind of growth that we're seeing is phenomenal. Although that doesn't have 2010 Q4, and Q3 is the same as the year before, so Q4, so it's a natural kind of growth is extremely big. But I guess a key thing from this side is that this is, you know, looking over a 3-year period. You know, affiliate marketing tends to lead itself to the very forefront of technology and different kind of business models to interact with the consumer. So, you know, pre-2007, the growth would potentially come from the search arena. You know, in 2007 to 2010, we've seen a lot of the loyalty, you know, interacting with the way that the economy is going, as shoppers become a lot savvier and searching around for more bargains on that side. So, I was going to ask kind of Florian just in 2011 onwards. What are your thoughts? Where's the next kind of growth areas going to come from?
Well, I think this space is one of the most exciting ones to be in, because we're always at the forefront of new models. And if you think about voucher codes, and it's probably the fastest growing business model ever in affiliate marketing, helped by a number of factors. One of them, that it was an existing model that was being taken online, and by the other one, obviously, with the economy over the last few years, people are probably becoming a lot more savvy as to their shopping. But if you can, you know, other models have grown just as fast. If you look at the rise of cashback sites, for example, and what it does prove is that the channel is very adaptive and it provides a playground almost for advertisers to try all of these things out and work with the ones that work for them. And clearly, voucher codes have worked for a lot of clients, as the stats are showing. But the other ones, if you look from 2011 forwards, we're already looking, we're already seeing some really positive signs for mobile, and we'll talk about that a little bit later on. And the other aspects that are kind of have come in through the affiliate marketing channel are behavioral targeting. And then there are some of the technology aspects like feed solutions and pay-per-call solutions as well. And we'll see a lot more of those rising through the affiliate channel and becoming mainstream over the next few years.
And just to emphasize this point, this is kind of just picking out one particular business model that is driving a lot of growth within affiliates. It's not just about voucher codes, which it can always tend to be. I guess the main thing that, you know, when I'm talking a lot to advertisers and brands about is to understand that the channel, it's not so much, there are the opportunities for SMEs, etc., and the small bands of affiliates, but it's becoming a lot harder to acquire the actual traffic from an affiliate perspective and to monetize it and to earn a living. And what we're kind of seeing, I'm sure Florian will say, is that a lot of the bigger guys are getting bigger because they have kind of the budgets to do that. But they are becoming brands in themselves. And as in that case, they need to be traded with and communicated with as brands, as businesses. Affiliates aren't just side things. And as you can see from one particular affiliate, Cashback, some of the media budgets are sometimes bigger than the brands are actually representing. So to actually trade, on their level, it is in that case, okay, well, there's some excess, or the CPAs are much smaller than compared to display or search even, is to, these guys, they have the kind of volume and distribution, and they need to be traded in that kind of way.
I think, particularly with this, it can't be overemphasized as much enough about what opportunities the channel also provides for people who are entering it on the affiliate side. We've seen a lot of companies become very big players out of really one or two man bands, and some of them, and they all go different ways on affiliate. Some the likes of Picture who and Cashback who are now is big enough to earn for themselves on TV advertising. Others have grown into agencies to be reckoned with, from the likes of Net Media Planet and others that have started purely as search affiliates, and today are recognized on search agencies. So it doesn't just provide opportunities for advertisers; it's really a breeding ground for absolutely excellent new technologies and upstart companies.
That's it. So now we're going to spend a bit of time just looking at USC, which is Symphony's media client, and just looking at the kind of steps that was put in place in this kind of case study to grow the program. I guess when we took on the program, it was kind of like a majority of affiliate programs at the time, is that it was left on that silo. There was no kind of clear defined goals or objectives for the actual channel itself. There was not a great deal of kind of communication or interaction with affiliates, and it was just no kind of great management of the program. And that's not kind of to point fingers. It can be just the way that some affiliate marketing or the affiliate marketing channel can be viewed. So what the first steps are is, from an agency's perspective. So from an agency's perspective, it's to really understand the business objectives of the brand. To almost kind of set the rules of engagement, the parameters that you can work with, and what was the brand and what is the brand looking to achieve out of the channel. What are the key things that it wasn't kind of providing? So it wasn't a volume driver. The actual average order value was relatively small from the channel. So to understand some of these factors, and then start to put the plan in place to develop the program. And I guess from your side, Florian, I guess this is not an uncommon scenario.
Not at all. I mean, I think you gotta also see all the parts of the pictures quite often, and mid-sized advertisers, they have limited resources to put into that, so they're looking for help with growing the channel. And you need to be a position for that, and you need to have the right vision for that. When 17th Media started working with USCs 2 years ago, Commission Junction came on as a second network and as a partner of 17th Media. And we at the same time, we understand that quite often also the network, and not in defense of any network, but also of the network that runs the program before, is that quite often the network is in a position where they're needing things from the advertiser that are difficult to get, where it can be helped immensely by an agency like 7Fix Media to kind of provide that additional bridge that is needed to make a program successful. And you can't underestimate of how much does go into in terms of interaction to make an affiliate program work. It's not something that you just switch on like a search campaign. It really needs thinking about it and interacting with it to actually become successful.
Absolutely. So the next kind of couple of slides, some of the underpinning features that we took on board when looking at the program. So, the key thing here is, and it's a bad kind of use very much in other media, especially search, is to kind of plan, test, and then to evolve from this. But a key thing is to plug in the KPIs for not just the affiliate program, but the affiliates themselves into the trading calendar, the actual comms plan for the brand, and then start to align those on there. So you can actually measure against kind of key trading periods. It's again kind of working in their isolation. It needs to be very much a succinct piece of a communication plan. And this is a key slide, especially for kind of affiliates out there, is understanding the EPC of the program. So for anyone who doesn't know, obviously EPC being earnings per click. And actually working, one of the things we're looking at is why is there relatively low EPC with some kind of publishers or the program as a whole, and then start to put in strategies about how we can improve that. There are a few different ways that you can improve EPC. If we look at the first one, is CPA, a way to inflate EPCs to simply kind of pay more. Now, this is not always a kind of sustainable way, but it is a way to kind of build up on the CPA. And then to look at the click-through rate, by giving compelling creative the offers and the kind of voucher codes out there, making it more of a strong offer, and then securing good placements in terms of trading with affiliates. Is a way, we all want to kind of improve on the click-through rate. And then I guess the third point, which some people in the affiliate side can say, well, it doesn't really apply on the on-site conversion, but you can start to improve that as well by providing a very kind of sound product feed. There's a lot of kind of third-party technology providers and even the networks themselves offer the technology to ensure that you are linking to the right places on the site, or ensuring that the right information is given to the consumers to give the most kind of weighted kind of click. And then reducing the customer journey. I know this kind of sounds quite basic, but there's still, from click to purchase, there still can be a number of, different pages or stages that this kind of goes through. To look to reduce that and understand with the own on-site analytics of where consumers are dropping off can be a very kind of strong way of increasing the on-site conversion. And then obviously just a roundabout way is the easy site, or the way that the site is easy to use and navigate around.
I think, and it's quite often, it's too easily underestimated of how important some of those stuff become in an environment where it's a question you only pay on the CPA anyway. So how much does it really matter? The more traffic I get to my site, the better, right? But the truth is, that's not entirely true. And just think, if you think about the flip side and the publisher that is trying to be, you know, trying to grow and maybe trying to throw a few ads up on telly. I mean, it matters to them, and every click that leaves their site that doesn't convert is obviously lost revenue in most ways. So those things will matter, and particularly to the mid-sized or smaller sized programs, they become a really key factor, because if it's a brand that may not be known to absolutely everyone, then publishers will look for those kind of things and decide on that basis if it's worth their while promoting that merchant or not. And it's as basic as it may sound, but it's, and I joke about, obviously, CPA increase is the easiest way to do it, but that's not always the most effective one, or very rarely is that the most effective one. It's really looking at the basics. Am I linking to the right pages? Am I actually considering the consumer's decision-making journey and where do I land them onto the site? And then how does that work afterwards? Is my site conversion-friendly to start with? And you'd be surprised across how many advertisers we come still today that we're looking at onboarding onto the network, and we look at their websites and we look at, it's like, well, have you had, what's your conversion rate like? And I said, well, that's not great, but we're not surprised. unfortunately, it does still happen too often. And really, those things, they may not matter to somebody else if it's just your own budget and you're spending it on the CPC, but then that's your own money that you're throwing down the drain. If you're doing this and you're trying somebody else to put goodwill into your program, then it matters very much.
Definitely, and you know, just to expand on that, the EPC, there was the kind of metric on there, can still be the shop front to your program, especially for kind of the longer tail affiliates out there. And so improving that, and especially with kind of conversion rate, making sure you have the right tools and products in place is a very kind of key component in driving more kind of recruitment to the program. Okay, and then a very last underpinning feature on that is segmentation. Again, it is looking at different kind of tiers. It's looking at the key volume drivers for the program and trading with them on a very much a one-to-one basis. Not only just having almost a tier split by volume, but understanding the different kind of segments and business models that your affiliates partake in, you know, because their EPC and their trading metrics are going to be very different based on how they acquire customers, whether they are obviously going from search engines or whether they're going into different other areas to acquire consumers. So understanding each of these different segments, and then working around devising strategies to implement with them is a very kind of key component. And then looking at that longer tail, making sure that you are engaging with them, not just leaving them be, looking at ways that you can incentivize them to come back. So there are a kind of a multitude of different segmentations that you can look to do within the affiliate program, and not just having a gold, silver, and bronze mentality on it. Would you expand on that?
Sure, I mean, there's a couple of things I think that are worth saying on this, and one of them is obviously the categorization is, and like we talked about mature programs earlier, one of the things that we start to look at when you've got a mature program is like, how do I fine-tune this, and where do I fine-tune this in terms of cost, where do I fine-tune it in terms of conversion, where do I fine-tune it in terms of where's the consumer in their journey, or where's the decision-making journey, what do I give that publisher to make that work? So if you can get that categorization right, you've got the basis for that. Obviously, the first place for a lot of people to look at is cost management, but all the other aspects matter just as well. And then the other part, I think that's quite often overlooked, and kind of, you know, you could look at it and say, well, I'll focus on the things that work and not so much on the ones that don't work. But in a channel like this, the nursery programs or reactivation campaigns or whatever you call them, actually, they can be your extra 20 or 30% of revenue. A lot of experienced affiliate marketeers know this very well and have very active reactivation campaigns for nursery programs.
And I guess, you know, as the programs mature, the reason why I'm doing this is as you start to understand the data and, you know, the traffic that comes from affiliate programs, then you can start to understand the incrementality of each individual segment, and then look at ways that you can incentivize more to, you know, get incremental or lifetime value from your affiliate base, and, you know, tying that, making sure that works in conjunction with all of the other areas. So, you know, having this is just not a way of just putting different CPAs, it's actually to understand where the value is being driven to your program. So once, you know, you have the building blocks, and once we kind of put the building blocks in place, it's then actually go do, as it were. You know, a key component of that is kind of recruitment. Now you need to, you know, focus on what the brand is looking to achieve. So USC being a kind of young, dynamic fashion brand, we wanted to ensure the longer tail content affiliates there and fashion bloggers are absolutely on the program. But what we need to kind of balance that with is then, you know, making sure the segmentation that we talked about is then we do have the aggregators, say shop styles and kind of cashbacks, quickos, you know, loyalty, and then some of the kind of the key sites out there. So, you know, it is not just kind of putting all your legs in, excuse me, as well. That's what flies my glasses. But it is having a kind of multitude or recruitment plan that focuses along, you know, different kind of segments.
I mean, it's probably those elements where they're working together, particularly if it's a tri-party arrangement with an agency, an advertiser, and the network comes really into play, and for the agency and the network, by working together, can probably make the biggest difference on an affiliate program. There's certain things that the network can enable and the agency can take care of in terms of brand messaging, etc. And it's here where we in the working together comes in and makes the greatest effect. It's not unusual for advertisers to get involved in that themselves, of course. Many advertisers I know will have direct relationships with the top affiliates as well.
And just on that, might be too controversial, but where do you see the kind of converging line on that? Would you say that there is an element for agencies, advertisers to have those kind of direct relationships, and then?
I think from a network perspective, I think it'll always be an individual case, so most of the times I think that will also be driven by resource consideration by the advertiser. Sometimes it's resource consideration by the agency as well. We work with, you know, you specialize obviously in this and you have a lot of those relationships directly, but we also work with other agencies that simply don't have the resource for that, or the merchant doesn't give them enough budget to resource that, so we take care of that. And I guess, you know, that's down to good agreements between all the parties.
And I guess, you know, obviously with number of kind of improvements that you have, the program have X number of kind of affiliates, and having that kind of dual partnership is that you're able to, you know, maintain relationships right from the top down to kind of mid to volunteer.
And I think it's like anywhere else, it's the working together that really makes a difference. And quite often, since we talk about the greater pool of merchants, we quite often are in a position to reach out to more affiliates than a merchant directly or an affiliate or an agency sometimes is. But at the same time, probably because we talk about such a broad range of merchants, if it's a mid-sized or something, if it's a mid-sized client, and the brand messaging may probably be better coming directly from the agency or from the advertiser.
Okay. Tactical offers, and, you know, we touched on this in terms of kind of growth seen in voucher codes. You know, there again is a kind of whole session in terms of the incrementality of whether it be voucher, cashback, etc. You know, from my perspective, without kind of going too off tangent, you know, supply that methodology on any affiliate is to understand on that segmentation, is to understand how they kind of fit in with your overall journey, and, you know, looking at the data and seeing, Now, where the overlap, whether it be in other channels or whether in the incrementality of the sales that they provide, you know, it doesn't always have to be kind of an always on. We're not suggesting it not to be, but you can use kind of the tactical offerings around it. The key thing is here is to match the tactic with the affiliate. You know, sometimes a strong tactic or offer, you know, would be better place to be, to confidential, so better place to be exclusive with one site rather than actually being offered out to many sites because of the coverage that you'll particularly get from that exclusive deal. Now, what you don't want to be doing, obviously, is then just be offering the same kind of exclusivity to your known sites. You have to back that up with other kind of consumer or publisher offers to make sure that not only is the top sites that you cater for, but also the ones that bring you the 5 to 10 sales, whatever it may be. And you know, working with a lot of brands, it's very hard for them to give kind of discounted product offers. What it can be is it can be looking at the current format that you're doing and changing the messaging or changing the tweaking the offer to kind of give that. So whether it be free delivery or the very key thing that we undertook in USE is to do stretch and save. So what you were asking the consumer to do is to spend a set amount and then receive a money off kind of voucher. Now the good thing about that is then you're starting to improve the actual average order value and you can set the margins based on what the client is. A very kind of key element. And then looking broader field and multi-channel is then to look at different vouchers and we're going to come on to mobile, but then to start to drive a bit of offline, online onto to offline things. So I think it's obviously a key thing is not to just be putting the same offers to the same affiliates.
What I would say is when you're putting offers out to the affiliate channel that you apply the same best practice as you would everywhere else. And to start with, whether you test, then you test your offers and you test which offers work well for your consumers as well as for the channel. And then if you're doing exclusive offers versus non-exclusive offers, I'd apply the same thing. Try what works, work out what works best for you, test both methods in some way and see what works for your brand. If you go to the effort to actually discounting and nurturing, then you might as well do it the best way possible.
And I'm just expanding on that tactical side, you know, for the best kind of coverage and biggest impact, you know, it is to look at it in a kind of tactical way. You know, the exclusivity, you know, building up to that can get a far wider distribution rather than just the same kind of discounted to affiliate site, because then obviously the offer gets quite diluted. Email as well. It's a very kind of cool function. What we did with this for USC is we're able to very much kind of segment in terms of if we're looking at the trading and communications plan for USC and particular times of year for them. We used email very tactically to focus on what they were doing. So in this case, we were looking at the student market, working on see a CPA. And we were able to drive a very focused offer to students to emails just with a university email address. So you're using the channel and the kind of publishers in this area in a very, very tactical and defined way, which has a very good effect.
I guess one thing that applies when you're email is just one of the categories, but I would say the same thing when if you are doing email within the channel, and it works best if you apply all the best practice like testing subject lines, testing different creatives, etc. It's what will make it work, it's what will give you good relationships with your publishers because you're ensuring the conversion and everything.
Perfect. So a seamless link on to innovation, I just think that. A key thing that we touched upon is the actual product feed. Working with people like FusePump, third-party providers of these, they're able to maximise the product lead and kind of put the structure in place to ensure that it's best practice for affiliates out there. What we're then able to do with that product lead is then to start to do some, you know, more innovative ways, looking at kind of that content units in a dynamic way that affiliates can then, you know, put in a bespoke manner to what the content they have on their site. It's okay, it's not exactly the cutting edge, but what the affiliates can do is make sure that they're applying the right content to the right, kind of content that they have on their site. Another key thing on this is we were able to then work with, say, Voucher Cloud, and then they start to join up the traffic that we have on the web, and then start to drive online with sites like or brands like Voucher Cloud. So it's a very key way, and we'll see more and more of this in the future.
I would say that this is the one area that a lot of people have started to look when they have successful affiliate programs, is that those new technologies, they may not do a lot when they first start, but it's very rare that one of them doesn't grow into something considerable. If you're doing it in the affiliate channel, why not just give that a try and be a trailblazer?
Yeah, and listening to a talk earlier about the innovation just online, the online space is innovating all of the time. You have brands like Google that are just putting out 5-10 products a week on this. Affiliates are innovating all of the time, whether it be offline kind of voucher codes or different ways to optimize kind of product feeds. And using that kind of plan, test and then evolve strategy, you can really start to embrace some of the technologies out there. You know, the core is obviously to make sure product feeds are in order and affiliates are using it in the most kind of effective way. But then once you have that kind of premise and that basis, you can start to expand into more innovative areas. And then, you know, a key thing is to focus on the relationship or the publisher management. Going to the pub for a beer with the top publishers, a great way, but it's making sure that we're involving each kind of area of the publishers that we have on the channel. So, you know, again, in that kind of segmented emails, way you work with the network in terms of sending out offers, you know, top offers through newsletters, and then working with the affiliate forums, very much kind of basics in what we should be doing, but making sure that the communication and understanding the communication that you are sending out is being received to the right people. And there is there's always going to be a one-to-many sending out that affiliates generally kind of work with on the program, but then making sure that you are then providing a more tailored approach to affiliates out there. And then, following that up, whether it be social engagements, whether it be kind of affiliate days, understanding more about your brand and the way that kind of affiliate marketing fits in. Again, there's kind of key elements on that. And then I guess a bit more from Florian's side, but making sure you're working with the network and developing.
I think the one recommendation for anyone launching a program into those channels that I would make is that to make use of those network opportunities that are offered by the network, whether that's publisher meeting days or other networking days. We're always surprised at how many merchants actually don't bother a meeting with their affiliates. If you actually go to one of those, the level of deal making that's being done at those events and the upside that comes out of those deals is quite often really the key driver for many of those programs. So don't underestimate it. And if it's offered most of the time, I mean, as far as I know, most of the times it's free, just do it.
Definitely. Okay. The results. For USC, it's quite staggering and kind of performance they did. And then just focusing, if we look at what we've kind of talked about, it's just putting the basics into place and the core aspects of that. Yes, there was a bit of innovation in terms of extending past the product feed, But the results of just doing the basics correctly, you know, now can equate to the channel really standing up. You know, to be 25% of online is from the industry staff, usually being 8%, is a very much a core part of the strategy. So, you know, doing the basics well can deliver a huge amount of results. It doesn't always have to be about the future gazing and everything else out there. And I'm just
I think anyone would love to be the affiliate manager that made the decision to appoint Zero Things Media there. And I think it's important to mention the time frame in that it was done. I think USC appointed Zero Things Media 2 years ago, and we partnered with them at the same time as a second network. And that was achieved only a year later. And I think the work really, there was more that a startup agency with some excellent experience in it can contribute to a client is probably not to be underestimated, particularly if you're a mid-sized merchant that may not have a ton of resources for it to use. So.
Yeah. And then just developing that. So what are, I guess, the five kind of takeaways that we look at? You know, it is very much understanding, it can lead more to your online acquisition channel there. There are generally three ways of kind of growing your affiliate program. It's to get more out of your existing affiliates, is to be recruiting more affiliates onto the campaign, and then looking at that kind of UPC model is to really improve the conversion that you give to your affiliates. And then to definitely kind of use the segmentation, not only by volume, which is more of the kind of standard approach, but really understanding the business models that they are. Reviewing your UPC, and then to definitely kind of build a relationship with the business side.
I think we might be out of time.
Yeah, just before, is there any kind of questions, and apologies for, Chris would have done this a lot smoother. But is there any questions? I mean, feel free to grab your flurry or myself afterwards.
Have you any thoughts on how to make affiliate links for SEO friendly?
Did everyone hear that?
It's a good question. I think it's a little bit down to technology. There are workarounds, and we work with a number of advertisers that have advertiser side tracking technology. So what happens is that the affiliate link actually links first directly to the merchant site and then gets tracked after it got there. That's a technology solution, and it's not straightforward, and it kind of needs a little bit of work from the merchant, but it's very effective from an SEO perspective.
Thank you very much, guys.